Hello, and welcome back to the Conversational Passport. I'm your host, Chelsea Lanham, and I am coming in live with my crew back here behind me. I have Q-Bert, her name's Q, but we call her Q-Bert, the puppy on the couch in between the two legs you see of the mystery man. There's his foot. I'm not showing his face because he is going to be a guest and he's a very special guest. And so the buildup and the theatrics is necessary. So right now you guys get a torso, legs, feet, and a dog. Look at that. You are teasing them hard. Oh my God. You don't even show me leg like that. Hey, saucy. So today, speaking of saucy, we are talking about cooking. We are talking about food. It is all the fun things today. And we are talking to Chef Kate McAloon. So she is a celebrity chef. And when I say celebrity chef, I mean like she has cooked for everyone. The Rock. Let me see here. I'm looking at the list. Miranda Kerr. Orlando Bloom, David Arquette, Courtney Cox, Sheryl Crow, Laura Dern, Tracy Anderson, Gwyneth Paltrow. I mean, the list goes on for days. She also, like I said, is the author of my favorite cookbook, The Flavor of Joy. I'm going to do an Instagram video, like a little book review, and show you guys the beautiful photographs. Get your mouth watering because these recipes are absolutely delicious. I want to show you some of her recipes. And I just kind of want to take you through her cookbook because it's more than just a cookbook. It's kind of like her life story. She gives us, you know, crazy stories on how she became Chef Kate. It was definitely not a straight road. She went down every exit on that road that you can imagine. And it's super interesting. And then she also shares lots of really funny stories about crazy kitchen mishaps when she was working with some celebrities that we all know and love. So just a really cool cookbook. She also gives lots of tips and tricks on how to create your own recipes at home, what to have in the kitchen, how to curate a healthy refrigerator and healthy cabinet, what to stock. I mean, she is just a girl's girl and I love her for that. And I also really appreciate her coming on my podcast, not just as a guest, but as my first guest. I was super excited when she agreed to be my first guest. She is airing as my fourth episode just because of how I'm layering these episodes in terms of different topics. But I couldn't sleep when she said yes. So this was really huge for me. And I hope you guys enjoy. This is just was a really fun conversation. So bon appetit. All right. We are here with Chef Kate. She is a celebrity chef and also the author of my favorite cookbook, The Flavor of Joy.
I'm so glad you have it there. I have some, I'm in Australia now and I have some in flavor with the U in it too here, but not as many as I have in America.
Well, I can tell you a lot of my friends have your cookbook.
Thank you.
This is my go-to every holiday, Valentine's Day, Christmas, like I love you gift. You get The Flavor of Joy.
What did you make? Did you make the one of the chocolate cakes for Valentine's Day?
I made the crumble.
The
fruit crumble. We actually, for those listening, I went to Kate's cooking class back in November at Salt and Straw in California. And it was beautiful. It was on a farm. And I felt like I was watching you on a cooking show because we had
it. It felt like a cooking show.
You can already see like cooking live with Kate, you know, like above the barn. And she was showing us all of these amazing recipes that are in her cookbook. And my favorite thing that you made was that crumble. And so I made that for Valentine's Day and Christmas.
Did it go over well?
Oh, of course. Yes. That's
you can
why
also
I made
do
it, for
it
both.
As a, sorry, you can do it as a tropical one too. You can use any fruit you like, even nuts, if you're not nut sensitive. So it's really a great basic recipe. And
Yeah. And that's what I love about your cookbook. So many things I love about it. I love how warm it is, you know, like your tone, like your joyous nature, it just shines through the pages. And when I read it, I'm like, this is exactly what a cookbook should be like, because I feel like you really exemplify everything that you want when you're sitting at a table with friends, good stories, you know, good tips, good quotes, and amazing food. And
thank you.
You always get tips on.
Thank you, but
well, I am just like laying it on thick, but I really mean it. I mean, your tips, like you said, you can like switch it out with tropical fruit. Like you do that all throughout the book.
Absolutely. It's a teaching book too. And it's a journey and a story. And if you really mess up, you can go get pizza and add something to the top of it.
There you go. Claim it as your own. I just think it's so wonderful. And my favorite piece about it also is that you tell your story.
Thanks. Yeah, I do. Only 19 pages with pictures. So it's not boring. And there's lots of pictures, and it's just a journey and an abridged journey.
Yeah. So can I ask you, where did this love of cooking begin?
It's a natural gift that came from my mother, actually. I can just taste things and remake them. I'm not a great baker, though I can bake, but I don't like to measure. And all the recipes work in the book because, you know, I measured and made sure other people that like that can do it. But I just feel and do that. And that's what I did for a lot of my clients too. I kind of feel what they'd like. They tell me their no list or their yes list, and then I just work with it.
Yeah, that's interesting. I don't have that gift. I solely rely on your recipe. And I'm like, if she says it tastes good, I'm doing it. So you can go So you can go to a restaurant and taste something and know how to make that at home.
Yes, but not like a cake or something that needs. When I was a kid, I used to try to make peanut butter cookies, you know, after school, whatever. And they wouldn't turn out right. And I'm like, why? You know, I was just throwing stuff in a bowl and sticking it in the oven. It's like, well, that's not quite right. And, you know, I didn't really realize because other things turned out.
Yeah.
I'm better at that now. I have a real idea. I'm doing here in Australia. I do recipes 2 a month for Young Living Australia. I'm their culinary ambassador. So they have oils that can go into food that are certified and all that. Mm-hmm. So they're healthy. And anyway, and I'm doing a hot cross bun loaf recipe. Ooh. Because who wants to make a bunch of buns?
Yeah.
You know? And that's a loaf. If you mess it up a bit, it's in the pan.
Right. It's whatever you want it to be.
And it's easier for other people because they also don't have to, you know, they have kids and everything else. They just don't have to do all the things like that. They've got it in a loaf and you can slice it and put, you know, like toast.
Oh, this is great. Like literally whatever you want it to be, slice it, bake it that way. And that's the thing is like your recipes are very accessible. Like I was inspired after your cooking class to start cooking class, like online. And yes. I like your recipes a lot better because everything is in grams.
Oh,
and I
yes.
don't know how to measure in grams. So I'm putting things on the scale and it's a mess.
Well, they have on your scale, they do probably have the button to switch. Yeah, that was hard for me too, especially when I'm eating a certain amount of food or something, which is, well, I'm actually doing that now. I'm shrinking, but which is hard for a chef because I was free range eating during the time in America. eating anything healthy, but a lot of it and a few of my amazing margaritas and grapefruit margaritas. So the scales can do that, but I actually prefer, I try to always put that and maybe the grams or, you know, in the recipe if I'm going to use them at all.
To make it easier to convert and go back and forth. Yeah. And you seem to be like an intuitive chef.
Yes, completely intuitive chef.
That was one thing I took away from your cooking class. And I'm like, wow. She really knows the perfect amount of berries to throw in.
Yeah. And then I tell you all that you have a recipe to follow if that's what you need to do. But that helps you to learn to be a little more intuitive and trust yourself. That's why I love doing the classes.
Yeah. And I love that part of your cookbook where you actually teach us how to create our own recipe.
You saw that too. You've read the whole thing.
Oh, I've read this cover to cover.
Thank you. Again, yes. I'll say thank you. I love that page. And then there's also a chart showing you if you wanted to use oils, how to put those in and what, you know, how to do it. Very simple, logical, but, you know, some people don't know how to do it. So that's why I always put my tips and my notes. And it's a little, may look a little longer, but it's just to guide you.
Yeah. That's your book. It feels like a life guide, a cook guide. Just an everything guide, the cake guide.
I'm so glad we're doing this in the hot garage. Yeah. I should tell you people, I'm in Australia and we're having a bit of a heat wave because it is still the end of summer here.
Oh my gosh.
And to be quiet because there's construction on the canal where I am. I've come into a garage. So the background may be absolutely lovely.
Oh, I'm honored at the dedication to yeah, show up for this podcast.
Well, you know, I'm losing weight as we speak.
So the way that I found your work was, I think I was on either Goop and I saw your brownies, your blondie brownies.
Yes, the blondies, yeah.
Or I saw it on Quora Organics.
Probably like, Quora.
Okay.
Probably Quora. I don't know if Goop still has it up on their blog. That was a few years ago when I cooked for her and then they asked me to do that. But you can always, I use that recipe and either with or without lavender, you know.
So I found you that way. And then when I introduced you to my friends, everyone was curious about like, how did you become Kate Chef? Which is why I started sending them the book. I'm like, well, you have to read her story. But while I have you here, I think your story is so inspiring. Would you want to kind of give like the Cliff Notes version of how you came to be where you're at?
Well, I always like to say by accident, because that's kind of how it was. I had a nightclub in the 80s in Spain, very upmarket. Then in the 90s, I went in the wilderness and built houses, gave away my money. And after that, I kind of needed to come out, reinvent myself. And the way this, I was in Hawaii eventually. And people like Todd Rundgren, some bands, one of the Eagles, they knew I could cook, but I wasn't really doing that. And so I went over and I did some catering and parties. And then I went in a real estate agency one day and I was doing a little declutter feng shui, just, you know, whatever I could do on the island. And I said, but I'm really a chef. And one woman came running out of an office and said, we've got a celebrity client. They're here for 3 weeks. And I said, who? And I didn't know who they were at the time because I hadn't seen TV for a long time. I
was living because you were in the wilderness for 9 years,
I missed
right?
the 90s of TV, basically. And they loved me. It really worked out. I had to rent a car to get to the other side of the island and I did it. And by that time I'd been in Hawaii long enough and I went to LA. Their chef was leaving. When I got there, their chef left earlier because she felt comfortable. And I took over the like two or three times a week with them. And that led to Courtney. And then people just started calling. I never planned to be Chef Kate.
Wow.
And then the Spielbergs called and Gwyneth Paltrow, all the people just through word of mouth. And I had also some ladies in Pacific Palisades. It was a different group, you know, whole yes. brunch and lunch and dinner group. That was really funny. It's like, they're not my normal people, but they passed me around too, you know.
So it really was all referral. Mm-hmm.
I'm a personal chef rather than private. I did do private here once for like a billionaire a few years ago. And, it's where that's a position and you're like a chef and you're, you know, breakfast, lunch, dinner, and you're an employee. That's not me.
Okay. So people would hire you for a shorter amount of time.
Well, you come in, you make a bunch of food for one, like for Orlando, you might make it for 5-6 days, once a week or once when he wants food and he's in town, or some of the people like that, or some of them like the Spielbergs, I might do 2 or 3 times a week. Or so it just depends on what they need. So in 1 week I might cook for 4 to 7 people.
So
when I was really busy.
How do you do that? Because I can hardly meal prep for myself. So how
it's
do
like
you?
It's like a whirlwind. You saw me in the class. And I'm preparing all the things at once, you know, like 14 dishes. I'm really good at that. I have a new client here, actually. It wasn't planning. It was kind of a surprise. I have a friend with the best, one of the top agencies in the world for actually nannies and staffing.
Wow.
And the day I came up a week early, I was in Sydney because I got stuck, you know, quarantine. And for 2 weeks, mandatory, you pay $3,000 for it. You have to pay.
Wow. Yeah.
So I was very lucky to get in, get a flight. I only decided a month ago on a Saturday morning that I'm going to fly over. It's like, oh, I woke up and it's like, am I going to St. Bart's? No, you're going to Australia. It's like, okay.
Oh my gosh.
And then
that's kind of how
leave.
You roll, right? You're pretty like just in the moment.
Mm-hmm. So always I had to leave. I decided on a Saturday, got the ticket for the next Thursday, more than a week. So whatever amount of days that is, but they called me on Saturday evening that, you know, within 7 days and said, you know, would you like to change your ticket? Would you like to cancel? Would you like, cause Australia had just started changing a policy of coming in on that Friday.
Wow.
And I knew that cause I actually on Facebook, it came up and never comes up. Right. And it was Prime Minister talking about how they were changing the policy. And so I know this is getting off the subject, but I said, what about the 20th? What about later? And he goes, and I said, okay, are you telling me I won't get out of the country? And I said, do you have something sooner than my flight? He says, tomorrow. I said, I'll do it. So I managed two bags because I moved, you know, I moved here again. So.
Oh my gosh. And just for context, everyone, last time I saw you was in November. And the very next day you were going to Seattle.
My sister's. And then it's like, time to get out of my living room. I'm going somewhere.
You're like, I'm going back to Australia.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's amazing. I didn't know,
but yes. Yeah. So here I am. And I have permanent residency here. So that helps.
Well,
I know. Talent visa, which is a little known visa, the only thing I qualified for. It's like, okay, thank you, in 2011.
Yeah, I feel like the world is your home. Like, you kind of just go wherever you feel like living in that moment, because you've had a lot of adventures like that. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and it's so interesting. When reading your book, I felt like you have lived so many lives. You know, like, you moved to Paris, and you had this very, like,
the Riviera.
That's where you had your nightclub?
No, that was in so there's, you've got Monaco in France, or it's its own country. And then in Spain, down in, it's a place called Marbella or Puerto Banús, is where like the Monaco of Spain is. And in the 80s, I had an English partner and we had this upmarket. You see the pictures.
Yes.
The hair is all giant than this for sure.
Lots of glitz, very 80s
really
style.
Went
so
to
beautiful.
Lots of parties. Yeah, I met Sean Connery there, and Shirley Bassey came to my club. So who knows? She sang Goldfinger in the James Bond movies.
Oh my gosh.
Pierre Trudeau, who used to be the father of the one who's there now, he came too after he wasn't prime minister. So they all came to my opening.
And was this the same trip where you learned where you went to culinary school?
I did that after.
Okay.
So I'd been to... No, actually, that was before, and then I went after that. So, and culinary school was actually not like a year of cordon bleu and all that stuff, which people think. It was in a 5-star restaurant because we knew the owners, amazing, one of the best restaurants in the south of France, because I went with my friend lot. And I wanted to go to, they had classes in a restaurant where they cook for you and you learn and you can help, but basically they're cooking and you have wine with it, but you learn a lot. You get the manuals and all this. And so I did that twice for a couple of weeks. I loved it. I came back a couple of years later and did it again, but it wasn't on purpose because I was just loved to cook, you know?
Wow.
So I had just done that and then I worked in their kitchen a month and then met my business. Actually, that's another story, but met the person that we went to Spain and opened a nightclub with.
Okay. So you get that. So you
magic
learned,
happens.
Yeah. The magic that I'm following here is that you went to like classes, right? Like you went to your
cooking class
for fun. Yeah. And then you go on to have this nightclub and then you then end up in the wilderness and you're living like a totally opposite life.
Yeah.
9 years.
Vegetarian.
Yeah.
Building, logging, solar, you know,
so
digging.
Okay. Explain to me that transition. How did you go from glitzy glam France and Spain to the wilderness? And where
my
in the wilderness?
My dad died in 1987, shortly after the wilderness, the thing opened, the nightclub in 86. I'm older. And I was kind of like, all my senses were opening up more. And it's kind of like, I'm sitting in the south of France, drinking like a $100 glass of champagne with berries in it with friends. And they're behind me. I'm saying, give me purpose or take me out. Basically, I got a lot more purpose than I ever expected.
Wow. They're like, buckle up, baby. Here we go.
Yeah, so I didn't know. But when I got back to America, my sister stayed and I went back because I was in Key West. There were somebody I wanted to see, which ended immediately. You know how that goes.
Yeah.
So that was a catalyst to get me back. And then I met some of the people from the wilderness and went across the country. And it was really all exciting till it wasn't.
Wow. And so you did that for 9 years.
Seven in the wilderness, but 9 still associated kind of. So it was a 9-year contract, I'd say, in my life.
And you would
my
cook
30s,
for the guests.
And I was hot. Yeah. I should have married them. Yeah, I was fit because I was, you know, working and sawing and doing
right.
All this stuff.
The core exercise that goes into all of that.
Yeah, my friend said, you have like abs. I said, what's an ab?
You know, you're probably tan, like nice arms.
Could
and you were super
snow.
Handy. Yeah, you're building houses. And you would cook for everyone, right?
Yeah, a lot. And so what you'd be doing, and this was good, obviously, prep for what ended up happening, because at breakfast, maybe somebody else might make that, but I'd be prepping for the lunch and the dinner. And sometimes there were 20 people, sometimes there were only 8, but, you know, so constantly then go out and build and still come back while that's happening. And, you know, so that really lined me up for making more than one thing at a time.
Yeah. And it seems
Chef
like,
Kate, I guess.
Yeah. And it seemed like you gained some spirituality there, or like you started to like read more books and you had like spiritual leaders coming to this. Was it a camp you were working at? Like a
retreat? Wilderness retreat center, but it was out in an old growth forest. If you want to say the words magic, it was amazing.
Wow.
And people would have experiences, and it was, pretty incredible.
And so was that
why a good part of it.
Yeah. And so you were cooking like healthy food for
these
people. Like I think you said raw food. Growing them.
We did raw food. Like, I did it one time. We decided to do raw food for 2 weeks, and you just make it exciting. And so I can do all those kind of, that's why it's easier with the clients. And then working with Miranda Kerr, which happened because of Orlando, like back in 2010, there were many more products that I was being introduced to and things, because not all my clients had wanted things like that. So basically that's my cookbook is written around many products that her mother and I and Miranda, because when I came over here, Therese, I stayed in their house and we got a lot of products given to us because of the Cora blog.
Yeah.
So I would just make recipes, all the baked goods basically, or things, like the coconut. And I had so much of that from companies. So I just
those berry muffins you made for Miranda are so amazing.
Oh, good. Because I'm going to tweak the recipe a bit and do a strawberry and lemon because one of the recipes I need.
and add
lemon oil and then some strawberries. I'll change it some, but I know that's a good base recipe.
Yeah, and it's interesting how you use essential oils, culinary essential oils in your cooking. How did that come to be? Because I was introduced to that through you. I hadn't heard of doing that before.
My friend here in Australia was already using them. And she kept saying, you should do Young Living. And it's like, well, okay, whatever. But I would try a little bit like in drinks, especially like lime and certain things. And it was great. And so at one point, right before the cookbook was to come out, she had told the corporate people here, and they contacted me and asked if I wanted to be the ambassador. And it was like, wow, right as my cookbook's coming out. So I had put some essential oils in the book, but then I went through and, did most of the recipes with it because I could have made the chart and stuff, so that I launched it actually up here on the Gold Coast, which is in Queensland, whatever year I did, I think it's 2016 originally, the Australian version. And so that was great. And people were just, I sold all these copies because people were just coming up and I was signing them. I couldn't even have a chance to talk to them. And I got on stage and I almost got sick. They had me get up on stage and I'm like, and that's, now I'm much better at it, but still I'm not a public speaker. I'm spontaneous.
Yeah. You're a fun speaker. I've seen you up in action. You're fun to watch. It's amazing what like those culinary oils will do, like 2 drops, and it totally like brings that flavor to life.
It does, doesn't it? And when you have something like a hot oil, like oregano, as we say here, there's a toothpick method. So you just need a little bit to give the flavor.
Wow. So. Yeah. And so, okay. So you leave the wilderness, you go to Hawaii. And then that's where you get connected to the celebrity clientele, was through the Eagles, right?
Yeah,
the party.
Megan Mullally and Nick Offerman. So she's from Will and Grace, and he hadn't done Parks and Recreation yet. I'll turn my phone off. Pardon me.
Okay.
Yeah, so that was that. And I would cook for them a couple of times a week. And there's a story in the book about the poodles really loved me. And they'd come and they're like, wow, those dogs really love you. Well, I was feeding them and I've been told not to, but it was like, okay. And so one day one of them threw up on their white velvet couch and it looked like confetti. Cause what I would do for them is cut their vegetables extremely fine. Cause that's how they wanted food hidden in their food so they'd eat healthier.
Yeah.
And so I got busted and I never fed people's dogs again.
Oh my God. That's hard though. They've got the puppy eyes. They're looking at you like, no one ever feeds me.
Here you go. Here's some turkey meat, but it's got all these little teeny bits of confetti, which is my signature.
Oh, so you're caught red-handed.
Yes, I'm completely and scolded, but duly. I should have been scolded.
Oh my God. Yeah. You have so many funny stories in your books about different like kitchen mishaps.
Yes. And they happened. They're going to happen to all of us.
Yeah.
Don't leave kitchen towels or, on your stove. It's like, don't do things like that. Don't kitchen.
That is a recipe for disaster. Yes.
And if you do, don't panic.
Right.
Immediately, people panic and then things get big.
Right.
I just roll with it. One time, I don't know if I put it, maybe I did the Pacific Palisades one, where they had a big, one of the big houses that was a long dining area where they'd be way down there. Well, the dining was in a separate room, but they had this where they'd have drinks and things. And then way back here was like the island. And then behind me was a stove. And maybe it was, anyway, I had a bunch of things going in the oven and they, one was too close and they got on fire a little, but I knew. And I said to my assistant, stand in front of me because I didn't want anybody to notice because all I had to do was, you know, to move it. But right. If everybody else had panicked, it would have been a problem, but you know, don't get things too close. But there were a lot of guests and I only had so much oven space.
Yeah.
And I knew what to do.
That's the key, is you were calm. You knew what to do. I would have been like hide. Swiping it with a towel.
Hide. And that would fan it. Your kitchen's now on fire.
Everyone run.
Yeah. Fire. I never do that. Cool so, under pressure.
Take.
Okay, well, not so, cool right now. But.
Yeah. Oh my God. I know. How much would you like some water poured on you?
Yeah. Or a swimming pool. I was at my friend's pool yesterday.
Mm. Oh, so take
we've
us,
had a bunch of rain.
Take yeah, us through on, your sorry. World a little bit. Like, so let's pretend, for example, like you've had clients like The Rock, who is very muscular, very big, yes. A wrestler, and then Victoria's Secret model Miranda Kerr, who has an entirely different body type and probably different dietary needs. So yes. What does it look like when they call you up and The Rock is saying, you know, I don't know how much protein that man needs, but I would assume a lot to keep that muscle yes. on him. And then you have Miranda Kerr, who we all know is very healthy. And, you know, she really is like a pioneer in that wellness world. What she do those is. Conversations look like when you're trying to understand your client?
Well, the do's and don'ts of what they eat. And so basically I get a really good understanding, like the new client that's going to start next week, if I do it. It's like, well, we'd eat anything in your book. It's like, okay, but I need you to do me some kind of diagram so I know. So I'm going to come up with some meal suggestions and things. And it, after a week or so, we'll feel our way into it. With The Rock, it was very specific. And his diets are online, so I'm not going to tell you everything. But I did put his cheap brownies in the book.
Yes.
So I call them Rockalicious because I couldn't get permission because a rock is a trade word. Trademark. I asked. It's trademarked. But, you know, here's my brownies. But certain amounts of protein, I'd weigh the food before I cooked it and then after. I mean, after, because it was a certain amount of food he needed to eat. And after a couple of times of cooking for him, he knew he could trust that I was going to do. If there weren't enough sweet potato fries, I was making more until I got up to whatever the volume of the thing was. So, and there were very specific things that it might change on a dime.
Like, so would you like take like, in a way, not maybe directly working with their nutritionist, but in a way like knowing, okay, he needs this much amount of protein.
Well, that it was specific. There was a map in that respect. With the others, there's never been one.
It's right.
More like, you don't eat red pepper or capsicum, as we say here. So, okay, I'll leave that out. Are you allergic to cilantro or you just hate it? You know?
Yeah.
so if it's already, if guest would come to Courtney's on a Sunday and it's already in the food, it's like, you know, that, oh, this person hates, well, that's not my problem. I need to know ahead of time. But if it's in there, they're not allergic and they can't taste it, that's okay. But I would always have, like, for some of their people, I'd have like fish on hand or things if the guest did show up on that Sunday after I got used to it. I did that for 4 years.
Yeah. And that must, as a chef, be like it must keep like you energized, right? Cause like if someone, like, I don't know, like I would imagine working with someone who's really healthy, like Miranda, you know, you're getting creative with substitutes where you still want it to taste good. Was that something?
Well, I use those mostly now. Yeah. I really haven't gone back except when I really like in America, you know, might eat something from the bakery. That's not me cooking it. That's me eating gluten and, you know, whatever, dairy and things that don't really agree with me either. So basically it's become a way since, you know, 2011, all these years, God, that's over 10 years.
Amazing. Yeah. and you were saying in your book that you found that eliminating dairy and like processed foods really helped you.
Yeah, I don't eat a ton of processed food, but all the allergies. And I just found out from somebody that a lot of people are allergic to yeast, and they think, and yeast is in a lot of things in your stock. You know, if you look at things, it's hidden, you know, you can look at the list, but they might not be as gluten sensitive as they think. They're allergic to yeast.
It's funny you say that.
Soy sauce. Are you allergic to yeast?
I went to a naturopathic doctor and she said, you know, I think your issue is not gluten. I think it's the yeast. And I was like, oh, I kind of thought they were one and the same. Mm-mm. I didn't know.
And I don't know all about it yet either. I should read a bit more since, and find out what they're in, because I'm, you know, that's starting Monday. I need to shop on. It's like, I hear some more yeast. I'm sorry. So I don't do that. I research.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, I think about like substitution. And for me, you know, whenever I'm creating a recipe and I realize, oh shoot, like I don't have this one thing, I'm always Googling like, well, can I replace it with this? Mm-hmm. Can I replace it with that? Are there any things that straight off the bat, you know, people might think you can replace with one another, but you don't recommend that?
Well, in my book, egg, there's always egg replacer. And for vegans, there's a whole thing we used to use in the wilderness. You mix it up in it, or you can use flax seeds. But if you're making my cake, that chocolate cake, that's basically 9 eggs and chocolate and butter, that's not going to turn out if you use, you know, 9 eggs worth of egg replacer. It's just not going to be good. So
that's,
I would say that.
Yeah,
I don't think that would work, because it's a mousse cake and it's a decadent cake, though you can use healthy ingredients in it. Still, it's decadent.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, like you would think an egg for an egg replacer would just kind of cancel each other out,
not
but it does change the texture.
I've never tried it, but I would feel, go ahead and try it. Use that much egg replacer and see if that works, but you're not going to get this chocolate moussey, amazing fudgy cake. I'm pretty sure.
No,
but
I trust
in baking
you.
That has other ingredients, like that cake doesn't have flour. So it's naturally gluten-free without having to substitute anything in it.
Okay. Good to know. And so I know that you like to go to the farmer's market on Sundays.
I went on Sunday.
And so when you cook for yourself, what does this look like? Like, are you preparing for the week, or do you kind of just go day to day?
Sometimes I just leave the house without eating and I go, where can I? I actually like going out. You know?
Are you
it's
a
harder
foodie?
To find you.
Like,
so,
do you,
but I put my,
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, so what? Yeah, I do. I go, I like, but now that I put myself on this strict plan for a few weeks because I need to, I'll eat. I make my food. I put ice things on it and I take it to my friends so that I'm not stuck without my food.
Yeah.
And I don't like curtailing myself, but like I said, I've been free range for quite some time and I gained weight.
Well, I like some of your tips where you talk about like freezing soups and broths. Mm. Can you share some of those tips that might make it easier for people who are trying to make meals one day to last them the whole week?
Yeah. Well, you need space in your freezer. Mm-hmm. And you need masking tape because you got to label it. Like I say in the book, it becomes a science project. Like, what was that? What's this bag of stuff? Or what's this container of stuff? So if you've got room, some people don't, you know, they have small fridges and freezers. But like, say you've opened a can of coconut milk to use in a curry or something, and you're only making enough and you don't want to use it all. I will often just freeze that either in ice cube trays and then put it in maybe a bag, even though we don't love plastic, but some way to store it and label it. So, and you might not be using the whole tomato sauce or the tomato can or whatever it is. And you can, these are easy tips, but you can just freeze little cubes or extra pesto and you can use them later in flavor in something else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you have room, it's good to keep your flowers in there, not flowers like roses, but your flowers and your grains, but most people don't.
I'm glad you specified.
I can just see people, all my flowers are really bad.
Got sunflowers, roses, everything. Yeah. Those are good tips. They're simple, but you know, like even, you know, when I prepare smoothies, sometimes I'll freeze like my almond milk and just throw it in with like my pre-portioned vegetables and fruits, and it makes it easier. You know, you save time.
Yes. And you're left to, if you've made more smoothie, you just freeze those cubes and you use them as the ice component, the cold component, and then remake more smoothie with it. So you've got that part of it frozen. Yeah, that's really simple.
Yeah,
and if it's not with vegetables, you know, if it's just a really nummy tasting, not that vegetables aren't nummy, but if it's something like you've made a fruit one, just you can make a little icy blocks. What do we call them? Popsicles.
Yeah,
icy poles are called here in Australia.
Oh, that's cute. Yeah, that's a great idea. Those are all really good, like simple things that are easy to integrate into any routine. And I also love how you talk about making like your own almond milk and your own like nut milks. Like I only make my own now.
Yum.
Yeah.
And do you make thick cashew milk sometimes, or do you do with cashew?
Yeah. Cashew is my first choice.
Yes. Because it's yummy and creamy and it makes great stuff for soup. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And so like, what do you think are like the essentials to have in a kitchen? Like if you're just starting out and you're trying to learn how to cook, what are like the main things you would say someone needs?
Well, a good sharp knife or two. I like a chef knife, you know, about so long and with a handle that I can hold well and chop. And sometimes I cut with my finger on the top of the blade. You know, I know how you're supposed to cut. I cut how my hand feels comfortable. I've been cutting a long time. So, and maybe a small good sharp knife, but I usually will use a chef knife for most things, a good peeler. Mm-hmm. If you're peeling your vegetables, which I do, if some things not, if they're organic, and I always try to buy organic. Good pan. You can have your own views about a nonstick pan, but if you're doing eggs and all that, find one that's less toxic or not toxic. Because when your eggs and everything stick, they look bad. But you know, if you're doing a photo shoot, use as much stuff in it to make it look nonstick pan. But otherwise, stainless steel. But everything sticks to that.
Yeah, that's great. About
food too, or kitchen, you know.
Yeah, kitchen. Kitchen utensils are always like the question that I get. Like when I started my culinary class, you know, I was Googling like, what is it that I need? And, you know, fortunately they did give like a full list of suggested tools, but they were suggestions. Right. So I'm like, where do I start? And so I got the blender, I got the knife, I got the pans. Yes,
whisk, you know. A whisk.
Oh, yes. Fortunately, I had a
spatula.
A whisk.
Some good spatulas that actually, you know, can really, not those hard ones. They don't, I like to scoop things. I even cook with the ones that don't burn if I'm making eggs or something. The ones that, whatever they call the silicone ones.
Yes, that is something I do need, is a good spatula. We're a little weak in the spatula department over here.
You can use your hands and your food processor. That's what they were given for. When yeah. It's kind of nicer to have the spatula.
Yeah, you can get more out.
Yes.
And what would you say, like if someone was, again, starting to cook and they were using your cookbook, what do you think are like the most accessible recipes? Like where should they start with your book?
Well, definitely the smoothies are easy.
Yes, and delicious.
The frittatas, if you're going to be doing, if you eat eggs, are much easier. Don't make the veggie burger. It's harder. It's the hardest recipe in the book, I think, because I made it one day for Orlando. For some reason, it's like, let's make him a veggie burger with beans, black beans. And it turned out great, but I just kept adding things to it until, so, you know, the list is a bit long and I sauteed the vegetables because I was doing other things. So that's a harder recipe, but people that make it and actually take the steps and all that love it. So I've had a hard time making it again because I have to read all the steps, but it worked.
I said to do what again?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's a few typos in every book. I always look and I laugh. And, you know, fine. No matter what you do, there's going to be a typo. What else is easy?
I think that your roasted chicken is good.
Oh, the roasted chicken's so good.
Like amazing.
I wish I had some right now.
Me too.
And just doing it in a pan with like throwing in the roasted veggies and that too. And you can add critter if you want to. Critter, I'm so bad. Because I was a vegetarian for 9 years. I call it critter. So you can add that in with the roasted veggies. That's another recipe.
Yes, your roasted veggies are like to die for.
And the fish and the curries. I love the curry. My vegetable curry, which you can add meat or prawns, fish. Shrimp. I'm doing all the Australian words that you can add to. That's such a go-to for me, my curries.
Yes, the curries are delicious. The only thing I haven't tried in the book, I think it's the only recipe I've yet to do, is the raw fish recipe.
Oh, well, you don't have to if you don't like it. You
know, no, I love raw fish.
I ate that for lunch in France.
I don't trust myself making raw fish.
You have to trust your fishmonger. You don't go to your grocery store and get your fish. You've got to actually know that it's salmon sushi grade or tuna sushi grade, because that's important.
Yeah, it makes all the difference, right?
Yeah, because, yeah.
Between being sick and not being sick.
Yes, exactly. And then keeping it really cold on the way to the house and just being, you know, slice a piece off and go, I'm eating raw fish, and dip it in. Say, oh my God, that tastes great. Or it's like, if it smells at all, get rid of it.
So right.
You just really got to trust your people.
Yeah. That's,
and it's not hard to do. And you freeze it just a little bit. I don't know if I put that in the book, but often they'll keep it really, really cold. So it's easier to slice just a tiny bit. You don't want it. You put it in a few minutes before, just so it's hardened up. But if you haven't, you know, I'm pretty good at slicing, but I don't slice it like they do on TV. I might do it this way this time, that way next time. Whatever I feel like.
It's your dishes. It's like rare art. Like it's never the same each time, right? It's always going to be different brush strokes for different paintings.
Yes.
So have you ever had a situation where it's like 11 o'clock at night and you get a call like, we need food now, and you have to like whip something together? Any 911s?
Sorry, not for that day, but the next, like somebody might be flying in. So I've never been asked to come over someplace. At Courtney's, I would be there still at 11, but you know, be cleaning up with my crew. So in the first beginning, I didn't have a crew. There was one girl that set the tables and made sure the drinks were done. But eventually I got somebody when they got a different house to do the barbecue and things. I couldn't do it all at one time. Yeah. And sometimes we'd have anywhere from 15 to 50 guests. You didn't know who was coming on a Sunday.
Oh my gosh.
So I would just, as I got used to it, I would buy more groceries and there'd be stuff in the pantry too. And I would just wing it and make more dishes and make volume of yummy stuff. And like one time I made a croissant bread pudding with Häagen-Dazs. I know this is before I cooked for Miranda, Häagen-Dazs of dulce de leche. I let it melt and I used that with things as it was amazing.
I was going to say, that sounds like heaven.
Yeah.
It was that heaven. Sounds amazing. But you just kind of like, yeah. You just kind of open the fridge and you're like, this and this will go good together.
That's one of my talents.
Yeah. That's a great talent.
What's on hand? What can I do with it?
Yeah.
That I don't have to go someplace.
And so when you're preparing for one of these events, you get an idea of what the event is, how many people are going to be there, their yeses and their nos for what they want. And then you go to the grocery store.
Right.
So and you do all the client, shopping.
Yeah, I do all the shopping. I like to do the shopping. One client in Sydney used to have Woolworths is like our Safeway here.
Yeah.
And they used to have the Woolworths truck pull up. They paid me great. And the food would all be sitting there when I got there. So I didn't really get to choose, which I like to do. But I thought, well, this is great.
Yeah.
I could rock up on a train, you know, just me and everything was there. And I'd make like, again, 15 maybe dishes and some of it I would freeze. And I'd get there. The fridge would be full with their stuff already. I'd be like, oh, please empty your fridge because there's no place to put the new food.
Right. Oh, that's like my dream.
The nanny would help. Huh?
Yeah. I said, that's my dream, just to have like a huge thing of food come up and I don't have to do the grocery shopping. It's just there for me.
You can order food, you know, during these times, which we
I know. I've tried a few times and they mess it up and, you know.
I like going to the store.
Yeah.
And here, there's no masks. There's
really,
it's really free.
Oh my God. Lucky. No wonder you left LA.
Yep. Well, I was actually in Seattle at the time.
Oh, right. Seattle.
And I don't like listening to the news either. So it was time to go.
Time to get out of there.
Yep. I'm going to drink some water.
Oh, please. Yeah. It's like, where in the world is Chef Kate? That could be your next.
Like Waldo.
Show. Exactly. Like Waldo. So
you're really good at this. Have you done a bunch of these podcasts? Yeah, you're excellent. I move around. I see myself in a tiny square.
No, I am honored to say and flattered that you are my first guest.
You're kidding. You're really good at
this. Thank you. I'm launching my podcast the second week of March. So I have a few more guests before that. And then I'm going to plan it. So each week it's someone different.
Okay. And where will you launch it and how and all that? I guess the guests will know by then.
Yeah. So I'm going to launch it on, YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and then Instagram. So everywhere. And so I'm going to put all of your information, a link to your book so people can buy it. And it's correct me if I'm wrong, because I remember when I purchased this book, it was not on Amazon, right? It's only.
No, I haven't. But I actually had met somebody in Hawaii in 2019. And then by the time I got around to it, it was 2020, so I just didn't do it. And that's okay. And I don't have thousands and thousands of books. Like I do things on a wing and a prayer. So, I just do it. I love bringing them to workshops and they sell. And that's
yes.
Cool. So it's the Flavor of Joy, but with a U, because that's my website. So I didn't.
Oh, that's right. Yes. And what actually drew me to your book is the word joy is actually one of my favorite words. Like I prefer it over happy. I prefer it over for some reason, joy just sticks. Like I just think like yellow and gold and it's like grounding and uplifting. But what made you choose joy? Because you use joy all throughout the book. You use it in your signature.
Yes.
Have you just always been?
Well, I was always saying the flavor of joy before. And I was at the market here. I think it was working on the book. and a lady who has a great coconut recipe book. And I've got another one that does brain food and things. So we're all sitting there talking. And I said, I'm thinking of calling the book The Flavor of Joy. And she looks at me, she goes, if you don't use that title within a year, I am. And I went, oh, I think I'm onto something, because I always would say The Flavor of Joy from The Flavor. It was my email. I mean, I was already doing that. So it was just natural. And I'm all about joy and flavor.
Yeah.
So, and somebody, people think it's my name or some kind of other site, but it's not.
Yeah. To look that, is that the one without the U? Yeah. That's why that one was
favor.
Taken.
No,
the favor of joy.
My spelling's not too good, but anyway.
Oh, that's amazing. So what's next for you? Do you have any other books coming out or new ventures of joy that you're embarking on?
Well, I'd like to do cooking classes again here. And since the country is open, pretty much, that would be fun. I love doing that. I do have this client that I'll hear today, but I'm pretty sure they said come Monday. And I also have Craig and Maria, who helped me lay out this book. And they're in the back and it talks about them. So I worked for 6 months with them. We'd have dinners and play and watch videos. But also, he's really amazing at moving things around and doing, laying out a book. So I was staying with them for 2 weeks before I came up here, which is another state, which is hotter. And they'd like to do another project together. I just don't know what it is. And I've got another lady that would like to partner. So we'll see. It will come together.
Yes, like it always does for you.
Yeah.
So my last question for you is, other than food, what else brings you joy?
Swimming and snorkeling in warm water.
Ooh. So,
but we've had a lot of rain, so the rivers, but I was in my friend's pool. So I like to swim right at the mouth of the river that's all turquoise, right at the mouth by the thing, where the salt waters come in too, because there's less sharks, I think.
Fair enough.
And I never swim at a beach when there aren't any people in front of me. Some people say, we love secluded beaches. I said, I like bait. I like somebody in front of me.
Someone else to be the bait.
Absolutely. Yeah. I will not get in the water if nobody else is there, because it's like, why aren't they there?
You like to serve food. You don't like to be the food.
Yeah, exactly. And I've heard stories. And I'm on a canal, but the canal has something called bull sharks, which apparently are all over the world.
Yeah.
And they eat people and they eat dogs, and you don't swim in the canals here. People still do.
I heard Australia is like one of the top places for shark attacks.
Yeah.
You are a brave
woman. I'm still here.
Yeah.
Well, in the beginning, there's a beach I used to drive up from another, you know, like a good 25, 30 minutes, because it had, and some do down, and so they have nets.
Yeah.
But I found out after going there with the kids and all this stuff is they don't go to the bottom. I was in this false sense of security. Nothing ever came in there. The nets don't go to the bottom.
It was like, probably better you didn't know.
It was much better, but then I never have gone in the netted area again, because if one gets in there, you're fair game.
Right. You're like, I don't want to test the waters. I'll just be thankful that nothing's happened since.
Yeah. So that is my favorite. I love, of course, travel, which has been a little curtailed, but hey, I can travel around here.
Yeah.
And I plan to marry sometime. I don't have somebody yet, but I'm there's somebody I'm talking to.
Because when I was
in quarantine, I joined a couple of sites. Hey, Chef Kate, it's about time.
For any men who are listening, Chef Kate is on the market and she makes a mean whatever you want, dinner, breakfast. I mean, that's got to be like a great like thing to say, you know, like when if I ask, what do you do? I'm a chef, like done. Yeah. Like,
I like
put
to
a ring
go out,
on it.
But
yeah.
It's a little hard to pin me down, however. I had somebody ask me on the phone that I was, you know, talking to. He says, well, what happens if I actually fall in love with you? You'll just leave. I said, if I actually fall in love with somebody, I'll stay. Obviously, you're not him.
Right? Exactly. And like, couldn't he go with you?
Well, that's what my friend said last night, actually. That's funny. Yeah, well.
That is too funny. Well, Kate, this has been a joy for me. I really appreciate you coming on. It's been so much fun just to hear your stories. I can't recommend your book enough, and you're just a joy to talk with. So thank you so much for coming on my podcast.
I'm so glad to be the first on your podcast. You may change the order, so hey, who knows?
No, but you're still my first. So thank you. I appreciate it.
Awesome.